My Dear, I Wanted to Tell You by Louisa Young. Read by Dan Stevens. Prologue. France, 7th of June 1917, 3:10 a.m. It had been a warm night, summery, quiet as such nights go. The shattering roar of the explosions was so very sudden, cracking through the physicality of air and earth, that every battered skull and every baffled brain within those skulls was shaken by it, and every surviving thought was shaken out. It shuddered eardrums and set livers quivering. It ran under skin, set up counterwaves of blood in veins and arteries, pierced rocking into the tiny canals of the sponge of the bone marrow. It clenched hearts, broke teeth, and reverberated in synapses and the spaces between cells. The men became a part of the noise, drowned in it, dismembered by it, saturated. They were of it. It was of them. They were all used to that. In London, Nadine Waveney, startled from dull pre-dawn somnolence at the night desk, heard the distance-shrouded crumps and thought, for a stark, confused moment, "Is it here? Zeppelins?" She looked up, her face the same low, pale colour as the flame of the oil lamp beside her. Jean scampered in from next door. "Did you hear that?" she hissed. "I did," said Nadine, eyes wide. "France," hissed Jean. "A big un." And she slid away from the doorway again. Nadine thought, "Sweet Jesus, let Riley not be in that." In Kent, Julia Locke sat bolt upright in her bed before she was even half awake, saw the cupboard door hanging open and thought foolishly, "Oh, thunder." But she was sound asleep again when Rose, in her dressing gown, looked in on her. In the channel, the waters wandered suddenly this way and that, in denial of the natural movements of tide and wind. At Calais, a handful of late carousing sailors paused and turned. At Etaples, a sentry woke with a sharp nod that he felt certain would crack his head backwards off his neck. "Crikey," someone murmured. "Hope that's us, not them." Two ruins away, a 16-year-old whore paused and shrank, her heart battering and shaking. Her 35-year-old punter fell away from her, unmanned as his blood hurtled elsewhere in his body. Beyond Paris, a displaced peasant sleeping on a sack didn't bother to wake. Sheep, less well-informed, panicked and ran to and fro. Their shepherds couldn't be bothered to. An upright piano stood in a field, gaping and rotting, where it had been since October 1914. In the reserve line, those who slept leapt awake. Those who sat by dampened braziers jumped. Those who leapt and jumped were pulled down by their comrades with profanities and muffled cries of, "Fuck's sake, man!" The Aussie sappers who had dug the tunnels under the German line and laid the 600,000 pounds of mines grinned and smoked. Ungentlemanly it might be, as warfare goes, but they had started that with their filthy illegal gas. And anyway, it's effective, which is all anyone cares about by now. Up the line, the Allied men in their trenches reeled with the earth around them and kept reeling until the earth around them let them stop. Above, a flock of starlings launched and circled, a counter-nebula of black on blue. Below, the fat rats scattered. Across no man's land, the soldiers flew up in the air and fell, and the earth flew up in the air and fell and buried them, whether they were dead or not. And the German artillery responded, and it all doubled, redoubled, an exponential vastness. And in Berlin, wives and girlfriends sat up at night desks and in beds. Locke and Purefoy had been ready for it. That edge was on the night, the edge that leaked something coming, something else, beyond the ordinary filth. Everyone wore a dulled alertness, So when they started, though it was a shock, well, it was always a shock. Locke was by the sack flap entrance to the dugout smoking, humming softly a song he was composing about bats. Purefoy was staring out through a periscope from the fire step, thinking about Ainsworth, Couch, Ferdinand and Dowland's brother, and Bloom, Atkins, Burdock, Taylor, Wester, and the rest. He was reciting their names, all the names he could remember, and their qualities, and trying to remember their faces and their voices, their Christian names and their little ways, and how they had died, and when and where. As the string of mines went monumentally up across the way, little landslides of earth trickled down from the ratty timber and sandbag ceiling onto their tea-chest desk. Locke grabbed his head, elbows round his ears. He barked loudly, wordlessly, then flung his arms out and strode into the body of the trench. Purefoy was already moving along the line, joking, clapping the men on their shoulders. In the answering barrage of shells, one took the edge off the parador 20 feet along. Purefoy and Locke and their companions flung themselves down in the homely mud of their trench, that 6 feet deep poisoned haven with which they were so familiar, and crouched under the parapet, shared the peculiar safety of knowing that the worst was already happening. London, towards Christmas, 1907. On a beautiful day of perfect white snow, cut blue sky and hysterical childhood excitement, Nadine Waveney's cousin Noel threw a snowball in Kensington Gardens. It hit a smaller boy they didn't know, smack on the side of the face, causing him to gasp and shout and lose his footing, and knocking him onto the uncertain icy surface of the round pond. Still shouting, the boy, whose name was Riley Purefoy, crashed through the filmy frozen layers and shot out again, gasping, shaking slush and icy water off himself until his hair stood on end and laughing uproariously. Noel, who was bigger, stared at him, unsure. Nadine, standing back, smiled. She liked that the smaller boy was laughing. She'd seen him before in the park. He was always scrambling about, climbing things, collecting things. Once they'd come face to face halfway up a conker tree, deep in the green leaves. He'd had a pigeon feather in his hair, like an Indian warrior. He'd laughed then as well. Jacqueline Waveney, well-dressed, high-cheekboned, self-consciously verging on bohemian, insisted on bringing Riley home to warm and dry him. They lived close, just across the Bayswater Road from the park gate. "Everyone comes here when they fall in," she told him, as they scurried along the path to the gate. "Or if they get rained on. We're the first stop for people in trouble in the park." Her smile was warm and her accent strange. French, though Riley didn't know that then. The house was huge to him, though quite small to them. He was taken through a hall to the drawing room. "Drawing room," Jacqueline said. Riley looked at the tall ceiling, the creamy panelling, the velvet sofas, the warm fire, the glossy peacock green tiling around it. Inside, Mrs. Waveney had him wrapped in a towel and his clothing taken away to be hung on the boiler. He was given hot chocolate to drink and some dry clothes to wear, too big for him. The people stood around him, noticing but not seeming to mind that he was really quite a common little boy. Noel was jolly sorry and said so gallantly. Mrs. Waveney thought, "Look at him, poor thing. We could probably spare those clothes." Her husband, Robert, the well-known orchestral conductor, looked in. "Hello there," he said, or something like that. "What's all this, then?" Riley knew who he was. He'd seen him crossing the park often enough to the Albert Hall. He'd seen his picture in the Illustrated News. Nadine, whose honey-yellow eyes slanted like a naughty fairy's, glanced and smiled. Riley took in the well-known dad, the friendly family, the cuddly maid, the paintings on the wall, the grand piano, the books on the shelves, the smiling girl. It was not like his house, though his house was very snug and contained his parents and his little sisters, whom he loved and ignored, except his dad, who had given him a clockwork grasshopper for Christmas and could still throw him up in the air. He was a fireman, and he said, Don't look to the fire brigade, Riley. It's a good job, but you can do better. Riley was neither shy nor ashamed to be there. He did not feel that he was in the wrong place. He tasted the hot, sweet chocolate, and he looked around boldly, and he knew that this was what his dad was talking about. Better. His clothes did not dry, and Jacqueline, who thought him sweet with his bright eyes and curly hair, suggested he come the next day for them. His mother, Bethan, a devoted woman of Welsh extraction and firm ideas, baked a batch of tarts that he was to offer as a thank you, and remembered to bring the tin back. "Don't know why," said his dad, John, in his undershirt in the kitchen chair, braces slung over his wide shoulders, looking at the paper. "It was their boy knocked Riley into the pond."
"It shows manners," said Bethan. "Go to the back door, won't you, Riley, love, and watch out for him," she called.
The middle classes were always after something from the working man. As if they didn't have enough. Not that I'd want it, fancy ways. Bethan had been known to laugh out loud in the street at extremes of fashion among the better classes. She watched keenly, fearfully, as her only boy went down the street to visit the other world.
"He won't fall for it, will he? He won't get ideas and resentments. We don't want it. He won't. We brought him up right."
She found herself murmuring a blessing for him as he disappeared round the corner. John rolled his eyes. Bethan was stuck and strung up about the middle classes, scared of them, wanting what they had, pretending she didn't, resenting them for having it, and on top of all that, there was her furious, head-tossing pride in being a working woman with no need for any of that, thank you very much. Riley didn't think there was a back door, unless he went down the side alley. He went to the front door. He arrived at the same time as another visitor, an older man with a beard and an alluring turpentine smell in a black velvet coat smoothed and shining with age. For a moment, Riley held back, thinking of his mother, wondering. But the man said,
"Hello there, young fella."
And they went in together. Riley, having been led to believe that posh people were standoffish, was surprised.
"Hello, Riley," called Mrs. Waveney. "Are those for us? How lovely of you. Noel, darling, Riley is here. Rings for Barnes, would you, and ask for some tea."
Riley soon worked it out. It is because they are not just posh, they are artists. On Sunday strolls in Kensington Gardens, Bethan took pleasure in pointing out to him different types of posh and how ridiculous they were. Jono the Thief would do a similar thing, judging whose pocket was worth picking at Paddington Station. Riley surveyed the old man's velvet coat, the beautiful woman's dark red curls, the taking a common-as-muck boy back to their very comfortable, beautiful house with the paintings and the strange items. A curved and shining dagger hanging on the wall, tiny ivory elephants in a glass-fronted cabinet. Artistic, definitely. Bethan would sneer, because her dad hadn't let her sing when she was a girl, and Jono would let them pass, because ones like that never had much cash on them.
"Top brews,"
Noel said enviously, and poked Riley's cheekbone. The silent girl smiled at him again, and Riley smiled back. They were in the middle of decorating a fir tree with ribbons and shining orange fruit and glass balls. Riley had seen such things in the extraordinary windows of Selfridges, the new palace of splendours from which he had been chased 2 days before. This one was not so big, but its colours sparked his eye.
"Come and help us," said Mrs. Waveney. "Can your little fingers tie these on?"
She passed him a clear, round glass ball, light as sunlight, pure as a bubble.
"Where should I put it?"
he asked.
"Wherever you want, darling," she said.
He stared at the tree. Glass balls dangled on the sprigs of dark fir, hanging, gleaming. Pink like a rose petal in the sunken garden near the orangery, pale green like the limewalk leaves in spring, blue like the flash under a mallard's wing on the round pond. There were too many bunched up at the top. He checked how many were still in the box, plenty to cover the whole tree. Carefully he fed the gold wire fixing of the clear ball round a sprig on a branch in the middle, quite deep in. It would reflect the light and balance the coloured baubles.
Without thinking, he undid a couple of the coloured ones and redistributed them lower down.
The older man... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.